Hi, this is JT, and this is a walkthrough how Whipper works. So first things first is let's create one and see. So there's two objects in the Whipper tab here. There's create and solver. The solver is the actual solver, but what we start with is create. Create is the create graph that generates all the needed objects, bones. So you can define how many bones you want, and you can create a bone chain according to bone length, which is what it does. So you can change, and this is done, so it creates the amount of bone with this actual bone length. So depending on the bone length itself, it will create a various length of bone chain. So deleting this. Alright, you can design to use the chain length. So depending on how many bones you want, it will create according to a specified length and will adapt the actual bone count to match the length. So accordingly, good. So this graph here that generates this with create graph is this graph with create. This graph looks a little scary, but what I do want to say about this graph is that it is mainly based on max script eval nodes concatenating strings of various format various issues. So it starts with the bound count here as a parameter, and it works because of that little signal parameter here, which when pressed execute through, and through branch is all of this below here, and each of these groups represents a group of action. The output is a scene geometry object here, which is a few parameters to control the objects. It ignores totally whatever goes under it, just draws. This is what actually the graph is doing. The graph is only evaluating this, is create a box in the scene with a show on off. All this part below here is ignored by the graph evaluation unless the parameter signal is pressed, in which case it, well, then your first does evaluate this, right? The through branch only gets evaluated if the signal parameter is triggered. Otherwise, it just passes through an array of index range from bone count. So, what happens when the signal button here gets through? Well, the first thing first, it goes here and checks bone count. And from bone count, it's generate an array of integer plus one, because we need a beef bone for skinning purposes and whatnot. So that's that is this little guy here. Right? Thank you. Which is the plus one here. So first things first, it does this. Then generates from this array of index, because that's an in array of integers of index. It goes through the first map here, so parses these index, and for each single one of them, does a create a bone in this branch here. Up to the eval max script. It sets some parameters, and because it need no, that's it. Yes, because it needs the actual bone size. It gets the position here from this, so it creates. So because it needs a position, it goes on here and creates this eval max script here, which is. Create the solver object. So the solver object gets created via max script, returned into the graph as an inode object, and is used afterwards in the graph here. It creates, it's assigned the phase controller to linear. So there's comments in the README about this, but basically it's because the phase is, well, it's the phase, and the linear controller is better for that because we don't want to have a Bayesian interpolation for that, for proper looping animation. So this is created in the middle of the world, so it creates a transform here. This is not really mandatory. I could have just sent a vector of 0, 0, 0, or just the x value here. Anyway. The other part here, it checks for bone length, and depending on if you want to use bone length or if you want to use chain length, you divide the actual bone count by the chain length to set up the length value of the bone creation chain here. And we're sending that back into string, into the max script. String before execution, so we have the graph inputting value as string into a string concatenation that will get max script eval. So for each indices in my first array, I create a bone which I append to an array, a new array that will be generated here. And this array is an array of inode objects, in which are all the bones themselves. And this little part of the graph sets the actual hierarchy. So it parses again the index plus one array of integers and uses that to get objects at this here, to get the objects, the various objects at the index that I want from the bone object. So it creates the actual hierarchy of objects here using all the information provided, outputs node array again here back, so it outputs back node array in there and creates a new range here, because range it's easier to use instead of array of nodes for the next one. Still using range into my map array to get the actual bone object here that I want, and inject his name into a max script function to set up the controller to be my MCG control rotation controller here for each bone in this in the array created. And again, transforming back into array of ints to parse again all the bones themselves, passing through this is actually the solver, right? So this is the actual solver. Let's get injected back into here. So I pass through the solver, and for the solver I do this. I say for each bone I say that your master object is the solver, so I get the actual master solver here, and for each bone I set in their rotation controller. Their rotation controller is the MCG controller, and I inject them their index to represent their position in the hierarchy. And from there I go here, and on the actual solver I go set keyframes, I go set animation with animate on at 0 and at 100. I do it twice for to set a phase on X, Y and Z rotations. So there is an animation ready to playback on system creation. I move the solver up 50 units. Again, I'm using the I object back into a max string, max script eval. And that's the end of the graph. And what this graph creates, it creates the root object, the actual bones hierarchy here, creates the solver object, positioning it 50 units up, and for each bone it goes on the controller here, which is set up the GT whip controller, and sets it index to be is position in the array. So this one is 1, this one is 2, and points directly back to the actual master. This is all can be done manually, of course, but it's tedious to do. So the more bones you have, the longer it's gonna take. So that's why I created create. So this is all created for the user in a single click. The point object helper here is just a point helper, and it can be rotated as the root, parented to anything. The solving of the sign will be done locally. So, next graph is the actual solver. So we create a solver, and we select solver. We can select it here in the viewport or over there. What I did not mention is that yes, you have the show on, off and display, which is trivial little UI thing that I love. So the whip solver, will go through the graph in a moment, but here's the main UI. It's set up by default with some cool little values that UI stuff, the custom UI. This is all done from the custom UI default workflow, but it's just about custom UI. So with a few options to turn that on and off. So each axis has its own set of parameters and solving. We also have the show or not icon if you want to display off for rendering. or because it bugs you to see that, you can also set 0, you can set the scale to 0 to 100. Well, I could unlimited that, but detail. So the graph itself, max creation graph, also whenever it plays, of course, the creator created the proper keyframes. So you see keyframes that are set here and here and are on phase, and phase here and phase there. So whenever you enable any of the solving by default on creation, there's already an animation ready to start with. Keyframes can be moved, of course. It's just keyframes. All right, the graph itself. So the solver is here. At the beginning of the solver, there's a bone count. Bone count is set by create and is hidden with the custom UI code. And I can show you, wait, in the graph. The custom UI code here is basically all about really about UI. There's not much, there's nothing else than UI functions in there. The graph does the same for create, I did not mention, but all this maxi graph, I got some custom UI stuff here too, much lower, because there's less parameters and UI options to set up. All the functionalities are really done with create graph and max script eval nodes. Back to solver. Solver, it all starts, like I said, with the bone count, which is hidden over there. This is the actual output, which is geometry output. I'll come back to this data channel compound later on, but for now, this is this one is controlling the actual if the icon is shown or not and whatnot, and sets the channel ID here. But I'll come back to this. This is the actual solving function that starts here with a pass through. The first node. Not the first node, but the last one in the tree is the mute system, which mutes and just sends the vectors 0 to the bound chain. So it sets it up back to skinning pause, if I may say so. Creates a rotation vector and the solving branches. So you'll notice that most of the naming convention does not use the Y as it uses for the X or Z, and that is because the Y is the first branch I created and I did not change naming convention afterwards. For instance, the min here, this one says min Z, and this one says or this min and X. So X and Z are specified. When not specified, it's because it's the Y. So I got three copies of the same thing here, here, and here. X, Y, Z. This is Y. And why is this Y? This is Y solving because the first one. Then I copied X, which I sent to X, and then copied Z, which I send to Z. I'll go through the Y one, but X and Z are exactly the same branched, three branch. So, with the number of bones count here, and this is used in here for the function. And as I said, I'll come back to here later, but passes through that. So, from this array, I pass through. This is where the start comes. So I have, let's say for 16 bone, I will have an array of 16 integers starting from 0 to 15. From that here, I use the input of the total amount, which is the number bone, which in my case would be 16, and I use this to divide 1 by 16, so I get a ratio. And from that ratio, I can calculate the actual solving solution for each bone in the for each bone indices from 0 to 15. This is value is sent into the main solving branch here, the sign solving with the sign solving compound. And the actual parameter for the sign solving, this is the frequency multiplier, in the UI. So phase amplitude frequency multiplier, right? We're here. Let me see there. There you go. I'll change that like this, so we can see part of the UI as I'm going through. So the parameters are here, phase amplitude frequency. After that, there's the clamp sign. So they are parameters here are ordered according to the way they get evaluated. Phase amplitude is the starting. We have the frequency multiplier, which is here. As funny as it sounds, it does multiply the frequency, but by changing the actual phase. It's not too sure I really get what goes on here mathematically, but that's how it's working. It's probably due to my compound that is doing something awkward. Anyway, it works, and that's the most important thing. So after the clamping, so I get a sine solution for each indices with its own ratio multiplier here. So all bone have a different phase, if you will, in that at a given given time. So they don't all solve at the same position. This value is then therefore sent to an add, which I add, which is the linear add. So I add the linear rotation to all bones in the same direction. After that is the actual square add. Notice that it's additive, so it could be in any order, the effect will be the same, but it's adding. No, in fact, the square acts on the linear and not the reverse. Yes, true. So yeah, the square adds to that one. Well, it's additive. So yeah, anyway. The square root, then the actual whip feature here, which whips, is the ratio of the index added to 1, so I have not a 0 to 1 value, but I have a 1 to 2 value, right? So I don't multiply by 0 here. Anyway, that values gets squared, the square gets squared again, and the square gets squared again, which gets multiplied by the width value that I want and divided by 100 again, added to 1 and multiplying to the incoming value, which creates the whipping effect. After that, I have a fade. Fade is calculated the percent, so percent, it's fading and rotations. Fade in, the fade out, and that's the end of the solving that is sent to the actual multiplier. Oh, that's funny, yes, okay. So so the clamping occurs at the end. Anyway, yes. So this is sent through the multiplier. Multiplier multiplies here. So this one, the actual end results. And I noticed that, oh, look at that. I have a bad logic here. But nevertheless, yeah, the multiplier should be after the clamping and vice versa. Or, oh no, I think that's it, good, that's the it. And then, yeah, I'm sorry, I do want to clamp absolutely on the multiplier. Sorry, yeah. Really. And then there's the clamping, also it clamps everything here on degrees. So that's it by degrees. And it's evaluated if I am solving or not here. So this is the whip solver. Prior to go to the controller, and so when this is the solver evaluates this, it generates an array, and that is what is going on here, is an array of vectors. My array of vector is as long as I have bones. So each bone have its own indices, 0 to n. Starting from root bone to leaf bone. These vectors are rotation vectors per axis, and they are sent into this array that this whipper data channel receives as array. So according to it creates the from the amount, I could have done that. This is about showing icon and the size of the icon. This is the actual amount of indices I need in my array. This that will be created here, and this is the channel ID I want to use. This is sent here, so the amount creates an array of range that will map into that function here, which is my solving function that we just discussed. It will create a indices and phase mesh data. So my mesh has the proper amount of value for its map channel. I need as many vertices I have as I have bones. this one controls if the mesh should be with or without the cube to be displayed on and off, and control the amount of data channel, map channel that I need, data that I need in my map channel, and sets the to itself here. And why is because, well, that is the try mesh that it outputs. It outputs the geometry, which is the try mesh here. So it constructs a try mesh that will hold the map channel in the channel ID specified here on that mesh. And the solver generates the mesh here in the scene. And the mesh is, well, the object selected here. That we can show icon. This is the mesh. So, for instance, if you use an edit mesh here and go in vertices, you'll notice that you have vertices here. So each of these vertices are positioned according to the values coming from the solving. The 50 is from the actual object here. All right, local. Oh, look at that. Yes, vertices didn't do that. This is a local value, but yes. So that's the solver. That is the solver. Whip control, which is on the bones. It's here. I could have done a little UI tweak to make this unsettable. I did not do that. So there's no even any custom UI in this graph at all whatsoever. I should have done so. So this is not changeable, but hey, nothing's perfect. What this is the master is set to the actual solver, right? So from that, it gets its map channel. From the map channel at the specified index, which is 11, not index, but the channel number, which is 11. It gets the vertex buffer from the channel. Vertex buffer, of course, is just an area vector 3 points that I've set into the solver here. I send that, which is the solving result. So each bone just pick up the master and say, what's your map channel? From the parameter index that is set previously, it says, oh, what index am I in that array of vectors? I'm index 0, 1, 2, 3, x, and get my values here, get my values at that index here, and send that to rotation, to radians, to quad, to rotation. If my index is 0, meaning which, if I'm the root bone, I just take my rotation. My rotation is in absolute world. If I am not the root bone, then I should concatenate my world rotation with my minus 1, my parent rotation, which will give me the local rotation that I will pass through the rotation. So this solver only knows of master, map channel, index, two indices to figure out how to rotate. It's not aware of any of its parent. It's not aware of any of its child, so it only gets evaluated once. This one knows nothing of the bones. It doesn't know anything of any max object at all whatsoever. It just exists there and generates solving according to parameters. That's all it does. So it gets evaluated only once. And we get here. A relatively good frame rate in max if I don't play too much in the UI. Kind of high. Yes, max drops sometimes. It's related to this thing here, which I've seen Explorer that generates a lot of callbacks. So I can select the wind solver here, and my frame rate is relatively still good, even though the parameters gets updated in the UI. So I can select this and press delete, remove this, remove the animation system here for a second. So I can show you that even if I go, well, I maxed out this at 100. I'll use this with 20. It's going to be a long chain. It creates the whip system. The bone chain exists. Without animation, my frame rate is kind of good because there's no graph evaluation going on. Nothing's changed nowhere when I press play. I have a sign solving on 100 bones and still running at a pretty decent frame rate considering the amount of graphs in the scene. There's 100 controller graphs on each of one per bone, plus the two one at the top here, the solver and the creator. So each frame, everyone gets evolved and to create a box and generate the solving. A solver does take a lot because it solves mats. That's the one that takes the most frame rate. So this is the how it works. Thank you.